What is up, Dream City Youth? It is Pastor Josiah from the Glendale Campus coming back to you guys with the final message in our series, The Power of One Word. We've heard so many messages, even in this crazy quarantine time, leading up to this last week, next week, and then in the proceeding weeks, we will be getting closer to meeting together. I can speak for Glendale, but you'll have to stay posted for Phoenix and Scottsdale, but we will be meeting next Tuesday as the Glendale Campus, but pay attention at Dream City Youth on the Instagram page and other announcements that we're gonna post so we can keep you posted on all things related to Scottsdale and to Phoenix reopening when we come back to meet in person. We are so excited to see you guys again. But with that being said, let me also communicate an important announcement that some may be aware of, but some may be hearing it for the first time. Today is actually my last message to all of Dream City Youth. And next Tuesday, Glendale's first Tuesday back meeting together in person is going to be Melody and I's last day at Dream City Youth. Melody and I have accepted the call to go help plant a church out in Colorado Springs. We've been praying about it for the last 6 or 7 months. And I'm super, super excited for what God is going to do, though we will be sad leaving our family behind here at Dream City. But I just want to say this real quick. What God has been doing in preparing for this moment has been amazing. The individual who is coming in to replace me is somebody that I've been vouching for and even praying about for months at a time leading up to this moment. Now, I'll share one story before I say the person, and that way it'll kind of bring home and tie almost in a bow the way that God gives his gifts when it comes to seasons and when it comes to people acting in obedience, because his plan is always best. But about 6 months ago, our former lead youth pastor, Blair Wood, we all love Blair Wood, had asked me when I first started praying about this decision. I felt like the Lord said my wife and I might be moving, but I started praying on it and I talked to Blair and he said, you know, I know that you're not leaving right now and you're just waiting for the Lord to give you confirmation, but if there's anybody that you can think of that would come in and absolutely crush it at Glendale, who would it be? Just so I can, you know, be praying into that and maybe even suggest it to our leadership. Only name that came to mind, I said, there's one person and one person only, and that's Kaden Matchett. That was 6 months ago, long before Todd and Renee came out to lead the Glendale campus, and even before I had shared with Pastor Luke or Pastor Joe about what God had, I felt, even put in my spirit. So we are excited to introduce Kaden Matchett as the person taking over when Melody and I leave. And we are so excited because he is such a humble and great leader that loves Jesus with all his heart. And he just got engaged recently, so he's got an extra anointing. So we are super excited, but I wanted to make sure I made that announcement because we are sad that we are leaving the Dream City Youth family, but rest assured, we are leaving the Glendale campus in great hands. I'm going to pray before we get into today's message. Our one word today is grace. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your presence. We are so grateful for who you are and what it is that you do in and through us as your sons and your daughters. God, I ask today that through the message, would you let it be your words, not my words? I pray that every word that comes out of my mouth that is not of you, that is not true, let it fall on deaf ears. But Lord, if I speak truth, let it be seeds that go deep into the hearts and into the psyche, the mental capacities of our mind, so that we can practice what we preach. We can practice what your word says, and it won't be like James 1:22 that we hear the word, but we don't do what it says. No, we would do what your word says and bring heaven to earth. Help us to understand your grace, your power. In Jesus' name I pray. And everybody said, amen. My boy Spencer's got a little snack for me. And today I just wanted to get a little bit of this in my system. I don't know what your guys' favorite candy is, but one of my favorites is Kit Kats. And I just want to... That's the good stuff right there. That's good. There you go, Spencer. Thank you so much. Now, Kit Kats, I love. I also love pizza. And when I eat pizza, I'll hold it up and I'll start from the crust and then eat outwards. And then for me, when I eat tacos, I typically hold it up like this and then I eat from the bottom and then I go my way outwards. I'm just kind of one of those guys that likes to go against the grain and what people are used to, you know? That's absolutely not true, by the way. I wanted to make sure that I had you guys see an analogy right in front of your faces. Spencer, I got it. Am I good?
Nah, man.
I'm good. Thank you so much. Appreciate it. I wanted to do that little cringy analogy. I'm sure even many of you, as you were watching, saw me put that Kit Kat like I was going to break it and then eat it the wrong way. And you just kind of wince even in your seat or wherever you're watching right now. Now, the reason why I do that is because I want to make a point. I believe one thing that is very true when it comes to the topic of grace. And I want to make sure I say this to precursor my message. When purpose is unknown or abused, abuse is inevitable. Let me say that again. When purpose is unknown or ignored, abuse is inevitable, as in it's going to take place. I still got some Kit Kat in my teeth. Give me just a quick sec. But why do I say that? If I don't know the purpose as to how I'm supposed to do something, how I'm supposed to go about something, then there's an inevitable chance that I'm going to go about it the wrong way. There is a way in which a Kit Kat was designed to be consumed. There is a way in which pizza and tacos was designed to be consumed. If I don't know that, then I'm going to go about doing it the wrong way. Whether it's because I'm unaware of it or because I ignore it, I will abuse the use for which it was originally designed to be. Now, why do I say that? I say that because John Bevere had put out a survey, this was a decade or so ago, put out a survey, and he asked all across the country, hundreds to even thousands of different Christians, what is a working definition of the word grace? He said, give three or more definitions of that singular word that we all know in Christianity, that we all understand when we look at Jesus or think of our relationship with God, the word grace. 98% of people said something along these lines. God's grace is an unmerited gift of salvation that forgives our sins. God's grace is something that we don't deserve, that we received as a free gift that forgives our sins. While that's true, it's not a full definition. It's not a full picture of what grace is. Now, that's true, and there's a reason why 98% of people surveyed said that very thing, but there was only 2% of people who also said the full picture of what grace means. Now, in the New Testament alone, the word grace appears 157 times. If something appears that many times in Scripture, I want to know what the meaning of it is, truly. Not just one meaning or an aspect of it. I want to know what the whole or the entirety of it is so I can know how it applies to my life. And grace is a word that we like to use a lot, so we got to get this one correct. I used to think that grace was something that was only bestowed as forgiveness, that we got a pardon for our sin. It was almost like grace was forgiveness of our sins, and then if we messed up more, we could always fall back on it. It was almost like a safety net. I remember having this revelation, or at least an epiphany that I thought was accurate. I told one of my mentors, this was back in 2016, I remember talking to him, I said, Pastor Scott, I feel like the thing that is so powerful about grace is that it's something that's given to us that even Jesus didn't have when he was here on earth. And the reason why I thought that was because I said, Jesus, if he would have sinned even once, the plan for salvation would have been lost. There was no grace for him to fall back on. Therefore, we have access to something with grace that even Jesus doesn't have access to. After I understood the full picture of grace, I actually started to understand how incorrect that is. Some of you might be sitting there listening and thinking, what? That's not true? No, I don't think so. How could we have access to something that even Jesus does not? That doesn't make any sense. We need to understand the full picture and the weight of what I'm about to say so that we can apply it into our lives. Now, I didn't tell you what the other 2% of the people surveyed said and what grace is supposed to be. And whether you've heard this before or not, if this is a truth you've heard before or you've never heard it before, even if you have, reiteration reinforces education. So you need to have it repeated so that you can remember how important this particular truth is. Here's what I believe a full definition of the word grace, which in the Greek is charis. Here's what I believe the full definition of the word grace is. God's grace is both his power to forgive, which is his plan for our life, and his power to fulfill his design for our life. Let me say it again. God's grace is his power to forgive, which is his plan for our life, and his power to fulfill his design for our life. Said another way by John Piper, grace is the pleasure of God to magnify the worth of God by giving sinners the right and power to delight in God without obscuring the glory of God. Let me break it down one more way that's a little bit simpler than that, and it's from Dr. James Richards. He said this, grace is God's ability working in man, making him able to do what he cannot do in his own ability. Jesus was sinless, and yet he was full of power from on high, from his Father. I believe that grace doesn't just equal forgiveness, grace equals power. And I'm going to prove it to you through Scripture so that we can understand together what this truly means. The full purpose of grace is to empower you to run to and rely upon God. I'm going to say it again. The full purpose of grace is to empower you to run to and apply to rely upon him, to apply yourself to what God has put in front of you, to be obedient to what it is that he has. If you don't hear anything else from this message, then I want you to hear Paul's heart in the New Testament and Romans 6 specifically. He says this, and before I say it, let me preface it by saying all of us have been here at one point. If you call yourself a believer, all of us have experienced this to one degree or another. He says this, so what do we do then? Do we persist in sin so that God's kindness and grace will increase? In other words, if we have grace and it's unlimited, then why don't we just keep on going on sinning and then ask for forgiveness later? Like, isn't God's grace that powerful that He'll forgive us no matter what we do? But he goes on and he says this, what a terrible thought. We have died to sin once and for all, as a dead man passes away from this life. So how could we live under sin's rule a moment longer? In other words, Paul is communicating a basic, let me repeat, basic gospel truth. That God's grace is not just for us to be forgiven, but it's our power to do what it is He's called us to do. That's significant because what we start to understand is that grace in and of itself actually keeps us from an unholy lifestyle and to run towards things that we thought were maybe even impossible or are impossible in our own strength. 1 Corinthians 15:10, and this is the key verse that I want to focus on. Paul says this, but God's amazing grace has made me who I am. And His grace to me was not fruitless. In fact, I worked harder than all the rest. Who is he talking about? Paul's talking about the 12 disciples, because if you remember, Paul wasn't one of the original 12 disciples. He came later down the line. He says, I worked harder than any of them. How could Paul work harder than the people who walked face to face with Jesus, lived 3 years eating the same food, being in the same places that Jesus was for 3 straight years? How can you say you outworked every single one of them? Here's what Paul says. Yet not in my own strength, but God's empowering grace poured out upon me. In other words, the thing that causes me to outwork even the disciples that walked with Jesus is the grace of God within me. Not just to keep me from a place that I'm sinning, but to actually empower me onto the tasks and the assignments that God has set out for me. God's amazing grace has made me who I am, he specifically says. So I'll say it again. The purpose of grace is to free you from sin so you can run and rely upon him. You can run towards him and rely upon him for strength. Now, I remember when I was in Bible college, I wish I could say this was back when I was even younger than that, but I was at Bible college studying to become a pastor. And I remember being there and I was struggling pretty hard with lust issues. And I remember in one particular instance, I would come home late at night and if my roommate wasn't there, I remember those would be the moments where I feel like I was tempted the most. And I remember almost thinking if I was gonna mess up, I was gonna do it on that day. And I'm not even kidding. It would go so far as I would look at the clock and I'd be like, all right, I'll sin all the way up until 11:59. But as soon as it hits midnight, I'm back on it because it's a new day. His mercies are new every single day. And I know he's going to forgive me. What I didn't realize is that mindset was my way of saying, I'm making idolatry out of the grace that you've given to me. And I believe that it was an abuse of what God had actually designed grace to be. Abusing grace is saying it like this, similar to the way that I acted like this in action. Because I can be forgiven, I will sin and depend upon His forgiveness to clear me out. But using grace for its correct intention is this. Because I have been forgiven, I will depend upon His grace to strengthen me and to run to Him and to rely upon Him. There's a right way to eat a Kit Kat, a piece of pizza or a taco, and there's an incorrect way to go about it. One way, and if you do it any other way, in a way, in a silly a way to analogize this, it is abusing the way that it was designed to be. Grace is no different. I want to use grace for the way that it was intended to be. Because if it was something that God gave to me that I didn't deserve, that I can't purchase with any amount of money or good works, then I definitely want to use it for its intended purpose. Paul Tripp says it this way, day by day, dependence on God is not a sign of spiritual foolishness or weakness, but rather a sign of spiritual wisdom and strength. It's almost like if you and I are on a day where we're feeling like, gosh, I feel so tempted, or I feel like I just want to do this or do that or whatever the case may be. And all of a sudden you start to have this moment where you say, but I need to rely upon God. I need to just desperately cry out for His strength. There is nothing about feeling weak in a moment and reaching out to God. I heard it said this way, hell fears the weakest Christian on their knees in prayer. Because no matter what, when you rely upon God, you actually are admitting and even looking up to the heavens to say, God, what you've designed here on earth for me to be, I want to be that. and you are using grace for what it's supposed to be. I'm going to get back into it with some stories and some analogies so you guys can understand it. But I want to make sure I reiterate, when purpose is unknown or ignored, abuse is inevitable. We need to know the correct use of what grace is supposed to be so that we use it for its intended purpose. Everyone at my Glendale campus, most of our youth, I should say, would understand these words or these four letters and what they represent. P-P-O-F. What does that represent? Praise, prayer, obedience, and faith. That's what I think makes up the Christian life, boiled down into four words. Praise, prayer, obedience, and faith. Everything can come back to those four things. I want to walk you down praise, prayer, obedience, and faith for how we're supposed to act upon and live in the grace of God. I told you a little bit ago that I said to one of my mentors, I believe that Jesus didn't have access to grace because if he would have sinned and he would have messed up, there would have been nothing to fall back on. The salvation of man would have been impossible because he wouldn't have lived a perfect sinless life. When I had this revelation of that grace is supposed to be our strength, I went back to my mentor and I actually said to him, I recant what I said earlier. And it wasn't the same day, it was a few weeks later, but I said, I recant what I said earlier about Jesus not having access to grace. He said, why? So the reason why is because I don't believe Jesus didn't have access to grace. I think he was the only person who lived on this side of eternity to use grace for its intended purpose, to empower you to live a lifestyle wholly set apart and perfect unto his Father and for us unto God. He didn't abuse it. He used it fully and completely with every decision for its intended purpose, to empower him to do in the natural what is only supernatural. And I believe that's what it's going to be for us here, even today, as we understand what that means. Now, let's start with praise. On the PPOF, praise, let's start there. The power of grace is that we have joy and we have access into his presence. That means that praise should never be dependent upon our circumstance, should never be dependent upon our emotional state, shouldn't even be dependent upon how good we are at discipline or lack thereof discipline, and it should never ever be dependent upon how did I do today? I didn't do very good, so I can't praise God. Or I did really good, so I'm... No. It should never be dependent upon those things. In fact, people have asked me before, how do I get into God's presence? Psalm 100 says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. In other words, if you come before God with an ungrateful heart, you're not going to experience his manifest presence. But when you come with the heart that says, thank you, God, I am joyful in all circumstances, no matter what my circumstance even looks like, I'm going to be joyful and give praise unto you. Because even if all hell has broken loose and my whole life circumstance looks like it's impossible to break out of, you're still on the throne. You are still worthy and you are still faithful. When you praise God like that, there's nothing that the devil can do. He could try to change it just like he did with Job. He tried to change his entire outward circumstance, but he couldn't take the inner joy and the devotion that he had to still praising God. And there's a scripture that many of you have heard. It's from Acts chapter 16, where there's a great crowd that gathers around Paul and around Silas, and they strip them, they beat them, and they literally are mocking them. They throw them outside of the city, and they're essentially beating them down because of their faith in Jesus. Now, they were severely beaten and they were actually placed in jail because they had gone against what was told of them to not preach in the streets or preach about this Jesus. They thought it was a heresy. So they throw Paul and Silas in jail. And all of a sudden, in Acts chapter 16, verse 25, it says this, Paul and Silas, undaunted, prayed in the middle of the night and sang songs of praise to God. In a moment that should have been the least likely time that someone should praise and worship, was the moment that something came from the inside of them. Something began to erupt within them. And I just imagine being a jailer in a cell next to them, just being there in the middle of the night and it's dark, and all of a sudden you hear someone start saying, I'm gonna see a victory. Like, if you start hearing that in the jail cell next to you in the middle of the night, you're thinking like, what are they doing? Like, what in the world? I'm gonna see a victory, pardon my voice, for the battle belong. If you hear that and you're not in relationship with God, you're thinking to yourself, okay, whatever, you keep worshiping and praising your God. But then in one moment, it says this, verse 26, suddenly a great earthquake shook the foundations of the prison. And at once, every single prisoner's doors flew open and the chains of all the prisoners came loose. Even though there would be people hearing Paul and Silas worship and think, yeah, whatever, God still was gracious enough to set them free. That's what our praise can do. It doesn't just get heaven's attention. It impacts people here on the earth. So we praise God and we can see how grace was imprinted in such a way that Paul and Silas allowed that grace to strengthen them, even in a moment that circumstantially looked like it shouldn't be a moment where they should praise God. And it set every single one of the jailers there free. And I wonder how many of them gave their hearts to Jesus because of their praise. Now let's go to the other one. It's praise, prayer. Let's go to prayer. God's grace empowers you to pray. A.W. Tozer once prayed this. He was a theologian and a very well-known one at that, who said this: "Oh God, I have tasted your goodness and it has both satisfied me and it's made me thirsty for more. I am painfully conscious of my need for your grace." So he says this: "Oh God, I want to want you." Because moments happen where we don't want God. So he prays, "God, I want to want you. I want to have the desire to be close to you." He says, "I long to be filled with longing and I thirst to be made more thirsty still," in Jesus' name, was his prayer. Why? Because he needed even the grace of God to empower him to be close to God. I think of the scripture that Jesus, it's quoted of Jesus in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7, where it says, "During Jesus' life here on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission." That even Jesus, who was fully God and fully man, knew that he had to depend upon his Father through tears and groanings and difficulties to be able to say, "I still need your closeness." We need God's grace to empower us to pray. And the good news is he allows his grace to do that. Now let's move to the next one, obedience. God's grace empowers us to be obedient. There was a story of a Chinese missionary and pastor by the name of Brother Yun. Brother Yun was somebody who found Jesus out of desperation. When I say desperation, I know that that can have certain connotations, but I need to share this story with you because it's not just based on a true story that happened a long time ago. This happened within the last few decades, and this man still lives and preaches the gospel today. He was so desperate to know of the God that people had talked about that he prayed for 100 days on his knees from sunup to sundown. "God, would you send me a Bible?" True story. Sun up to sundown, 100 days straight. That's over 3 months. "God, would you send me a scripture?" And on day 100, this wasn't his plan. On day 100, someone comes knocking on his door, opens it up, and they say, "Are you Brother Yun?" And he said, "Yes." And he says, "God came to me in a vision, and he said, you need to go to this house, and I need to give you this Bible." And it wasn't just this crazy, miraculous thing that happened, and it wasn't just coincidental. This man had never even heard of Brother Yun, and he went there because God not only gave him the vision of the man and what he would look like, but the address at which he lived. In turn, Brother Yun took this Bible and in 28 days memorized the book of Matthew. 28 days, because there's 28 chapters in the book of Matthew. Imagine memorizing a chapter of scripture a day. And because he had never preached a sermon before, he just went to a nearby village and he began to recite Matthew for the people to hear from chapter 1 all the way to the end of chapter 28. And signs, wonders, and miracles broke out that day. And he's still living and preaching the gospel today. God's grace empowers you to pray, and God's grace empowers you to be obedient to the call of God in your life. And I believe his testimony is not just one that is, it's an anomaly or it's something that's rare and could never happen here. I believe it can happen in any of our lives if we so choose to take God at his word and know that his grace empowers us to praise him, to pray, but also to be obedient. Now let's move straight to faith. God's grace empowers us to exercise the faith that he has placed inside of us. There was an individual by the name of Antonio. Antonio was a friend of mine. And I remember there was a moment where him and I, we were in this internship together. This was about a few years ago. And I remember being at this church. And there was this moment where the Lord gave me this vision. And I saw, and it was so random. It was this vision of singing over my friend Antonio. I was like, "That's weird. Why would I sing over Antonio?" And I don't know why, but I felt like I would rather be obedient and be wrong than be disobedient and then find out that was God speaking to me. And so I remember like getting a few of my guy friends that were around and say, "Hey, I don't know why, but I feel like God wants us to just hear Antonio's heart and then just sing over him." And they're like, "What do you mean sing over him?" I'm like, "Just follow my lead." So we get Antonio in a room and I remember like looking him in the eyes and be like, "Dude, how are you doing? Like, really, how's your heart?" And he began to share things actually haven't been going very good. And then he shares some family issues, some issues even within the context of his job. And we didn't know all that was going on in his life. And I said, "Antonio, here's what I want you to do. I just want you to bow your head. And we're just going to sing over you." He's like, "What?" I was like, "Just let us sing." And we began singing over Antonio as we prayed and praised over him. And I said, "In my life, be lifted high in our world, be lifted high. And I began singing this song, a throwback, back when I was in high school, this worship song over him. And what Antonio said he experienced in that moment was God so close to him. He experienced his presence in a way that he hadn't in such a long time. And I called him about 6 months ago and I said, Antonio, do you remember that? And he says, of course I remember that. That to this day is still one of the single most powerful moments I've ever had in my life, that God spoke to me through your guys' praising and through your faith and through your obedience. And it just reminds me, even when God tells you to do something that seems ridiculous, when you're obedient, man, he always does something in the process. When you exercise your faith to see what he wants to do, it'll always blow your mind. I'd rather look like a fool and be in the middle of God's will than try to settle the approval of all men and all women around me, but not have the approval of God. That would be a scary place to be. I want to end with this because I believe this will kind of bring home what the purpose of grace is. Because remember, when purpose is unknown or ignored, abuse is inevitable. John Bevere, the person who put out that survey a decade or so ago that I shared at the beginning of this message, he tells the story about his dad. Now, his dad worked for Honeywell. Honeywell puts out a lot of different things, but one thing they're most known for, or very known for, producing and manufacturing is fire detectors, smoke detectors, and even carbon monoxide detectors. Now, a carbon monoxide detector is something that's extremely important because if you go into a room that has carbon monoxide, you can get poisoned even though you can't see it. You would inhale it, you would breathe it in, and it can actually kill you. Honeywell produces these detectors and these sensors that make sure that all of the rooms in the factory where they have to have carbon monoxide, where it might be emitting, they have to have these detectors read accurately so people don't go in there, breathe in too much, and then end up passing away or being their health being harmed. So he asked his dad, and he was talking to some of these people who manufacture these detectors. They say, these detectors, how do you recalibrate them so that they can read accurately? They have to read accurately. And they told him, the way that we make sure that these are calibrated to accurately read whether there's carbon monoxide in the room or not is every single day we take the detectors out of the rooms where they are and where the carbon monoxide can be seeping into the room as we're manufacturing things. And they said, we take the sensors out, we take them apart, every single one of them, we clean them out, we sanitize them as much as possible, we put them back together, and then we go, and you have to take them specifically to a clean air room. You can't take them to just outside and clean them. You can't just take them to another. You have to take it to a specifically clean air room, clean it out, take it back into the room, set it back up, and then it'll be accurate. It'll read as if it's at zero on the scale. And he said in that moment, as he was learning how to recalibrate sensors in order to read the different toxins that could be in the air, he said the Lord spoke to him. And he said, that's exactly what my presence is for. And John's like, what do you mean by that? And God said, your heart is a sensor. Out in the world is the poison of what has been in a fallen world. There is sin all around you. There's immorality all around you. There is brokenness and tragedy all around you. But every single day, you must make your heart sensitive to the things of my voice. You must make it sensitive to what it is that I'm speaking to you. And when you go out into the world, you have to come back daily and recalibrate that sensor. You have to come into a clean air room, my presence, and open up the Word of God, which is cleaning out those sensors of your heart so that when I send you back out into the world where I've designed you to bring heaven to earth, you could begin to make sure that revival is taking place all around you. And every day you do it all over again. You see, this is why it's so important that we understand that the purpose of grace is to empower us to what it is that God has called us to do, and not just to save us from when we've sinned accidentally or consciously. Because when purpose is unknown or ignored, abuse is inevitable. One last story. There was an individual who might be listening to this message. Her name is Brianna Juarez. And she came to Melody and I. This was back about in January, so about 5 or so months ago. And she came to us, my wife and I, and she specifically shared, I had thrown out my back. I herniated a disc. It was doing cheerleading, and it was something that she didn't expect, and she was scared to go to the doctor and then have to go through potentially surgery, and she would walk around and only be able to bend her back about this far, and it would be excruciating pain. If she sat down for class, it was difficult. She laid down for bed, it was difficult. But in one moment, as we began praying over her, and my wife laid her hand on her back, and I put my hand on Brianna's shoulder, I said, God, make right and realign what is not right and not aligned in her body in Jesus' name. And what I couldn't do in my own strength in that moment, God, through the place of praise, prayer, obedience, and faith, supernaturally brought physical healing to her body. And in a moment, she began crying because for the first time in weeks, she was able to bend over completely pain-free. She was able to move around, dance, scream, whatever, because she had been healed. I believe when we use the power of God and the grace of God for its intended purpose, there's no telling what He can do here on earth, bringing heaven to earth. Abuse is inevitable when you don't know the purpose of something. The purpose of grace is to free you from sin, to empower you to run to Him. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for my time here at Dream City Youth. And though I know next week I'll have time with my Glendale campus, this will be the last time I'll be able to speak specifically to Phoenix and to Scottsdale. And Lord, I just pray for every student and individual listening to this message, they would understand your grace, as 1 Corinthians 15:10 says, is to empower us, to give us the strength to do it. We couldn't even do our own natural ability. I pray, Lord, that people will understand that the purpose of grace does include forgiveness of our sin, and that they would understand that this nothing we could earn or deserve. But Lord, let it be said that there are individuals in Dream City Youth who understand that the purpose of grace is to do supernaturally what we can't even do on our own strength in bringing heaven to earth. We love you. We praise you. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you guys. We love you so much. We'll see you soon.